Welcome, everybody. I am I'm the Dean of the School of Architecture, and I'm really thrilled that we're able to host this event today and be part of what I think is a pretty extraordinary 2 days. I'm assuming that everybody, or quite a few people, went on the tour yesterday, and there's a pretty remarkable sort of mini publication that was prepared that that actually documents many more projects than were toured yesterday. But I think the spirit of this and the spirit of the tour is really something very important, which is to examine the legacy of New York as a kind of innovator in terms of thinking about the public realm and thinking about housing. I wanted to, of course, not only welcome everybody, but thank a few critical people here. I'm not even going to attempt to introduce or welcome specifically all the speakers. I hope that each moderator will do it. It's an incredible group of people, and I sincerely appreciate everybody's contribution today. It's an all-star lineup, and again, I couldn't be more pleased. But I will say a special thank you to both Bill Menking, who will be speaking on one of the panels, as well as Karen Kuby, who helped organize this as part of the IPA. And I also wanted to give a special mention to Jonathan Kirschenfeld, of course, who's the founder of IPA, and maybe a brief applause for the three of those people. I think they've done such a great job. The IPA is a very interesting new organization. It is, for those who, I'm sure many people know of it already, but I think obviously for thousands of years, cities have been a place for individual opportunity and achievement. That's what probably one of the most important reasons they exist. But I think at the same time they were emerging as these places of opportunity, I think people very quickly recognized that in order for cities to be that vehicle, there needed to be an active, successful, vibrant, and very powerful public realm. And I think that that kind of dimension to cities waxes and wanes, and I think the IPA is dedicated to making sure that we're in a waxing phase. And I think it is very important to think about the public realm. It's if you do it right, if it's successful, if it's well done, it's something that doesn't work just some of the time for a few individuals. It works 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And I think it's even fair to say with long-lasting cities, it works forever. So it's really important to make sure that the public realm is done really well and done right. And I think that's very important. I also think one other dimension to the IPA, and I think that's part of the importance of today's event, is it's not simply a kind of organization where people get together who are like-minded and remind themselves of the importance of the public realm. But at this point, today, there are going to be people, active researchers supported by the IPA. This event itself is a kind of research initiative so that the IPA is not just emerging, is not just a place, I think, where people kind of talk about things that they already know, but it's going to become, I think, increasingly a vehicle for new ideas, and it's going to be a kind of innovator in and of itself. So we're very happy to be part of that kind of emerging dimension to IPA. I think we also welcome the IPA because, like the IPA, we also are very interested in research into the public realm. Of course, we have our longstanding Pratt Center, and I want to give a special mention to that, 50 years of research into the public realm, originally founded by Ron Schiffman, who of course is here in our audience, and dedicated to, in a sense, bringing planning out of the back room and making it part of the community, making community-based planning an essential component of understanding cities, then directed by Brad Lander, who's of course now a councilman in Brooklyn, and Adam Friedman, who I see seeing back as well as our current director, kind of adding that in a sense level of expertise to understanding and transforming the public realm. With respect to today's event, I would just say a few more words and then I'll turn it over uh, to uh, to Karen and Bill, probably one of the most essential components of the public realm is, of course, housing and the way we think about housing and the way we think about housing in the city. And I think that's what today's event is all about. And there's kind of two dimensions to it, both the interior realm and the exterior realm. Obviously, the establishment of understanding the apartment itself, the spaces of the apartment, the ways in which people have access to light and air is very much, I think, defines our humanity as a city, as kind of city dwellers. And I think kind of an essential part of understanding what housing is and how it can reach everybody, even though it is interior private space. And of course, the public spaces that the city fabric, that housing as city fabric shapes, that housing much more so than probably any other kind of component of the city shapes the spaces that, again, we live in 24/7, 365 days a year, that it's an essential shaper of our lives. So, and I think both dimensions will be considered today. And I think there'll be various experts and various specialists who will be describing all of those aspects of housing. I think what I love, and I'm going to just kind of quote Bill Menking and then turn it over to all of you, is that it's very important to remember that New York City is really, I think, the quintessential innovator in terms of thinking about modern housing and the city and high density city in the modern metropolis. And I think that's really what's extraordinary about these 2 days, is we're looking at both our legacy as an innovator, as one of the premier places in the world, willing to experiment, willing to take chances, willing to create new types of housing and new types of cities. And I think today we'll be actually starting to discover the next step in that extraordinary legacy. So welcome, everybody. And I think now I turn it over to Karen Kuby. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you very much to Dean Hanrahan. We're thrilled to be here at Pratt and has, as you mentioned, to be associated with the phenomenal legacy of work in the public interest and in housing with Pratt Center and the school. So as you mentioned, I'm the director of the Institute for Public Architecture, and our organization was founded in 2009 by Jonathan Kirschenfeld, and we host a residency program for architects and allied professionals that allows them to develop work in the public interest. And I do also want to take a moment to thank a couple of people who have done some extra work. Dean Hanrahan mentioned the booklet you have that was produced by Linnea Moore, who's a Pratt student who's done a ton of good work on this project. Also, Brian Grady has been our community liaison, and he's the reason we have a lot of amazing community-based housing advocates in the audience and on stage. We're here today because we're ambitious about housing. We, as individuals here, architects, planners, historians, advocates, all of you, and also, of course, right now as a city, we're very ambitious. And this symposium is about saying, yes, we need new ideas. We also need to look at what has been tested in New York. And so today you'll see a series of case studies. So each case study is going to be presented as an argument for how we can move forward and what we've learned. And there will be three sections today, three panels, each of them with a variety of disciplines coming together. So stabilizing neighborhoods, enabling quality design, and then the last one, total reset 1 year on. So the first is looking at housing-based strategies that operate at a larger scale that really help to stabilize neighborhoods so that people can stay where they are. Enabling quality design looks, all of this will have a thread of design, but that really asks, you know, if we really want well-designed housing, what are the conditions that will make that possible. And the third is looking 1 year after Mayor de Blasio declared a total reset on public and below market housing, and where are we today? So for us, this connects to a program. I mentioned our residency program. The first iteration of that was this summer, and you'll hear from most of the fellows today. So this is an extension of IPA work under the title of Total Reset that responds to the mayor's initiative and presents ideas to take us forward. So in the case studies today, and also from the new ideas from our fellows, they'll be making arguments for how to achieve some of those goals. And so these are our four fellows that were selected through a process, and they produced an exhibition that was held not in a fancy museum, but instead in the space of below market housing in Harlem, in Sugar Hill, designed by the architect David Ajay and developed by Broadway Housing Communities in association with No Longer Empty. So it was about looking at ideas on housing in the space of housing, making it accessible to a wide public, and that's all archived at totalreset.tumblr.com. And we were thrilled to have that work appear in the Times. What this is about is really pushing a conversation forward and also supporting the people who are doing this work. So I'm thrilled to be here today with our distinguished guests and with Pratt, and look forward to a robust discussion. So I'll introduce someone who's been instrumental in producing this from the Pratt side, William Manking, professor at Pratt.
Okay, thank you, Karen. And thanks to the IPA and Tom for that a really nice introduction to kick this off. I really just want to get it going and say a few words in addition to the thank yous. For those of you who were not on the bus tour yesterday, we were able to see a good many of the historic models of different typologies of housing in New York, from the early union philanthropic housing, amalgamated houses on Grand Street, to housing built for tuberculosis patients, again, philanthropic housing. We saw urban renewal on the Upper West Side, and then we stopped at 116th Street and Morningside Drive and overlooked Harlem, the ever-changing Harlem, and heard from Richard Pluns, whose great book on the history of history of housing in New York City, he addressed in his comments. And one of the things that we had asked him to talk about, which is something that may come out of the symposium this morning, is he says in the preface to that book that efforts that were created in the 19th century by all these philanthropic housing attempts still have not been addressed, or certainly not answered, in the 20th century. And now here we are in the 21st century, you know, with our mayor hopefully trying to develop or build 200,000 units of affordable housing. And maybe the question then is, for the 21st century, how much will we be able to answer those questions posed by the 19th century? As you know, New York City has never really been able to catch up with housing. It's always been an issue in New York, right from almost the beginning, when the first non-Dutch immigrants began immigrating into the city. We've never been able to keep up with the tremendous demand for housing. But we've tried, and that's what we looked at yesterday with these incredible models. You know, some of them limited in what they teach us today, but all there and vibrant and still being lived in. So this morning, we'll be able to look at some more of these as in very specific panel discussions, in more specificity, and try to come to some of these conclusions and wonder where we are in the 21st century. So, with that, let's get started. I'd like to introduce Daniel Hernandez, who's the moderator. You want to come up, Daniel, of the first panel. Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm going to ask the panelists to just come on up so we can get started. I'm Daniel Hernandez. I am currently, in my life, the Deputy Commissioner at HPD for a new office that was opened as a result, or started as a result, of the housing plan that was passed in May of last year. It was an amazing undertaking to actually just walk in the doors, and everyone basically were saying, oh my God, I'm so glad you're here, because we have all the stuff we've got to do. And so when I read titles like Inventory of What's Possible, I inherited an almost impossible task of actually just started with identifying like what my staff was, who they were, what their capacities were, and then what our alliances were with other city agencies to actually get the housing plan moving forward. The Office of Neighborhood Strategies is actually, it's a great moment in housing history, I think, in New York City. So I'm so honored to actually be the first person to take on the seat in that office. But it is the greatest part about the housing plan is that it made an affirmative statement to actually open the doors of New York City's planning and office and HPD, Housing Preservation and Development, and the Economic Development Corporation and the Small Business Services and other sister agencies to actually say we are going to undertake neighborhood planning with communities. Now, people's eyes may be rolling, and many of the people on the panel's eyes may be rolling at how we've actually walked out the door in that, and I'm willing to take a lot of the heat on that because, I mean, I think what we have inherited, again, is a historic moment in that we aren't well practiced in doing that. Many of you are because you have committed yourselves to community engagement and community planning. As most of you know, city planning and HPD have mostly done what Euler planning, which is an environmental review process that most of you know already, in support of development. But as you know, engaging people in the process of envisioning and making decisions about their community is a tough task, and it's an exciting task, but yet a tough one. So part of what I did when I first walked in the door was to begin talking to the commissioners and the other agencies, and then finally heading to Ford Foundation and Deutsche Bank to fund a three-month, four-month process for us to be able to understand a way of working together, a governance structure, if you will, as well as a planning process that we can all plug into, a sort of plug-and-play playbook for planning. And we're about to finish that and unroll it. And so I'll be out in neighborhoods and working with hopefully some of your organizations to talk about how city planning and how we will do neighborhood planning into the future. We hired Good Corp. I don't know if you know them, but many of you may know Good Magazine. It's a great magazine. And Gail Studios, and they joint ventured to actually convene the three most important agencies in this process, EDC, DCP, and HPD, and how we might work together. But it's a process that many of you already know. It's that early engagement, data gathering. I mean, planners, as educated planners, many of you are in this room. It's that early phase of just identifying issues, the next phase of sort of coming up with scenarios, the final phase in actually making decisions. But it's intended to be a transparent process to engage communities. So we're transforming, hopefully, what's impossible to possible, and hopefully we'll be better as we move forward. So I guess rather than roll your eyes, I'm asking for patience. It's a moment where a lot of cultural change is happening inside of these agencies, and I'm tired at the end of the day, but it's the most exciting job I think I've ever had. So anyway, I'm going to go to my panelists because they are also people who are pushing me daily to think new ways. And they're I feel like even though they're very critical of us sometimes, they're also, I feel and hope, they're also friends. So I'm proud to sort of be on a panel with them and help moderate this discussion. I believe we're going to go in the order that's in your handbook with Nicholas Bloom beginning. So we're going to look at both sort of, you know, policies that have shaped housing in the United States, and then actually bringing it down to a community level and the ways of community have engaged and empowered themselves to develop housing prototypes and neighborhood strategies. So Nicholas Bloom will go first, and welcome. Thank you, everybody.
Good morning. I'd like to thank Karen and the IPA staff for putting this together. So in reviewing the de Blasio administration's excellent Housing New York plan, I think it's notable that the word ownership appears 27 times in a document of 41,000 words. And this, I think, almost near omission, says a great deal, I think, about the ways in which affordable housing is developed in New York, nationally and nationally today. But I think that the sidelining of ownership, I mean, it's there, except for developers. They do get to own things, leaves out a major legacy and source of inspiration. Because it's New York's grand, if still debated, and not always seamless, legacy of subsidized cooperative ownership. So in the writing and editing of our new book on the history of affordable housing in New York, it's with Matt Lassner at Hunter, from Princeton Press this December, with contributions from many people in the room, it became clear that from a long-term perspective, some of the most successful of New York's 20th century experiments in subsidized housing combined ownership with subsidy, and sometimes a lot of subsidy. So, you know, you may be familiar with some of these, what I consider to be success stories, which after their ups and downs are some of the largest and most successful cooperatives in the world. Co-op City, Rochdale Village, et cetera. And many of these were built by the United Housing Foundation, which admittedly failed spectacularly. But since that organization's collapse in the 70s, most of these have been managed independently on a limited profit basis, often with the help of additional state aid and supervision. As a result, most are thriving communities today. So I'm here today, however, to uncover another very useful and less familiar and less stormy precedent from New York's history of subsidized housing that should be reconsidered, and that is city-funded and supervised construction programs to create basic, large-scale, below-market cooperatives. And there is a very fine precedent in New York for building that way. I'll give you a little bit of history. I'm a historian, but it won't be long. It won't be too painful. So. This was a program known as the No Cash Subsidy Housing Program of the New York City Housing Authority. It was a massive, locally funded program of public housing for those with incomes too low for the private market and too high for either federally funded or there was a state-funded public housing program. So the rents covered most of the cost of maintenance and debt service, and low-cost city land added to the value. Apartments and complexes were developed to higher standards than most federal public housing, but almost all were basic red brick towers in the park. It was, after all, about the 1950s primarily from when these were constructed. Get a sense of the scale of this city program. It was enormous. So the Housing Authority was cruising along in the 1950s, building a lot of this very popular city housing. And they ran into big problems politically as private developers basically criticized the growing role of government in a part of the housing market, this more middle area, that the developers felt, I think with some justification, right, that they could serve, especially if they had those subsidies. And of course, they would stand to make a modest profit, too. As a result, the city program ended in the early 1960s. Most of these city developments, most of which were already tenanted, were eventually integrated into the Housing Authority's general inventory of public housing. And then this is when you hear about federalization and things like that. Most of these have ended up with a federal subsidy. And a lot of these developments, such as Woodside Houses, Ravenswood Houses, Palmanok, have been and remain some of the most desirable of the New York City Housing Authority's developments. They were built to higher standards, et cetera. And they're still red brick boxes, by and large. So the precedent that I think is of interest here is not so much the conversion of these to sort of traditional public housing, but the ones that were sold off, the conversion to a cooperative model. So the Housing Authority had a number of these developments in the pipeline and basically sold them as cooperatives. And I think that is a strong precedent, potentially. They were sold as nonprofit cooperatives. A number of sponsors were found, a mix of educational, nonprofit institutions, churches, et cetera. And most were eventually subsumed into the Mitchell Lama program. This portfolio today, still around, includes very successful developments such as Village View on the Lower East Side, Luna Park Cooperative in Coney Island, and more. And you can see the scale of it. We're talking about over 7,000 apartments. They were, as you can see from the sale price, et cetera, they were targeted for what we would consider to be really sort of the middle class in this era. I think also it's notable that most have required additional state subsidies since they were constructed, but they also have remained important anchors of affordably priced housing in many neighborhoods, including the Lower East Side. They have allowed for modest appreciation and have encouraged, and I think this is very important, residents to take care of their neighborhoods and, of course, to run them. In essence, the Housing Authority acted as a no-profit developer, building quality, basic housing that created an opportunity for long-term resident management. And I believe that the Housing Authority could do that again today. So, based on this precedent, very successful in delivering large numbers of units very rapidly, I would propose that the Housing Authority, NYCHA, which has enormous latent powers in the construction and finance field, create a subsidiary that would develop basic, high-density, high-rise housing on either NYCHA open spaces or other city-owned sites. These would be financed by a combination of government financing and modest down payments by buyers, all to be sold or managed under a cooperative or nonprofit model. In exchange, resident owners would have price appreciation limits and other supervision. This would be similar but not identical to the approach that the Housing Authority took in the past, and it has a lot in common, although it's not identical to what is done, for instance, in Singapore in terms of selling state-constructed housing to residents, but also maintaining a strong role for government in basically recapitalizing, fixing up housing in the long term. And the people in this room, I'm sure, can fill in the architectural, other kinds of details. I'm not saying that we should build identical red brick buildings, let me be clear. And finally, I think there are some real benefits that would accrue from this kind of proposal. There are social and economic benefits to NYCHA developments. If you add more, I think, middle-income residents to these developments, I think you'll have more eyes on the streets, people concerned about the landscapes in a very different way than you currently have. Either land sale or ground rents, even for this modest housing, could produce some returns for the Housing Authority and could be part of, similar to the land lease initiative, could be part of ways of fixing up some of the surrounding developments rather than just putting in new developments and leaving the others without a plan. And I think a lot of this could be step-up housing for many of the higher-income NYCHA families which are still there. I predict a much brighter future for NYCHA, and that's one reason I would make a proposal like this to many observers. I think with its scale, its essential nature to the life of the city, the engaged tenant activists, the new dynamic leadership, billions in the FEMA funds, a lot of federal, state money, which will be flowing in, and potentially city funds, I think that there is actually going to be a lot of repair, and I think the developments will be on the mend in the next few years. And I believe that construction of affordably priced, middle-income cooperatives could be a vital part of the new mixture on these NYCHA campuses, and to their bottom line. A new era of resident ownership would be more than housing. It would contribute to the city and NYCHA's civic and social vitality. Thank you.
I forgot to say also that I was told not to go into long introductions for every person, so that's why I just introduced Nick very briefly, because their bios are in your program. So I'll just be introducing their names, and then they'll come up and speak so that we don't waste time on stuff that's in front of you. The next speaker is Gabriella Bendiner Vianney, so she'll speak next. Thanks.
Thank you, and thank you, Karen and the IPA and Pratt, for having me and for hosting this wonderful symposium. I'm Gabrielle Bendiner Vianney, and I come to this world kind of with a mixture of disciplines. I'm an urbanist, a photographer, a curator, an environmental psychologist. And so I'm interested in thinking about this stuff from an experiential perspective, and to think about also the ways in which creative practices and kind of the space of exhibitions might be a space for conversation around this kind of work. So I'm talking about Spura, the Seward Park Urban Renewal Area. It's hard to talk about Spura as a case that worked. If any of you know it, it's kind of a big mess. But the mess is interesting, and the ways in which the mess crosses over and touches on a lot of different pieces and a lot of pieces of this history kind of makes it an interesting place to look at, and also to look at what's happened there in the last 5 or 6 years. So this is the Seward Park Urban Renewal Area circa 1960. This is actually from a pamphlet that was advertising the idea that we should tear all these things down. So this is on the Lower East Side of New York. It's about 14 square blocks. east of Essex, I'm sure. If you don't know it, you have been there. It's the weird spot of south of Delancey, just south of the, when you come off the exit from the Williamsburg Bridge. So when you walk through Spurra, you know something is wrong if you don't know what happened. This is what happened. Circa 1970, so this is the urban renewal plans. Part of what happened there, and I'll kind of talk a little bit through the history, but what I want to talk about today, and I could talk about the details of its history kind of forever, but what I think is important and what I want to propose to you today is in thinking about the ways of talking about Spurra as a way of the possibility of starting community level conversations, kind of in response to some of what Daniel was thinking about in kind of reimagining kind of community level planning. So the idea of starting a community level conversation, not in response or opposition or modification to a plan, which failed spectacularly for 40 years at Spurra, but as a model of community planning that's kind of a way to define the questions that a plan should address. And to talk with you a little bit about my involvement with a project called Spurra Matters, which was in partnership with people here at the Pratt Center, as well as Goals and Place Matters and a bunch of other community-based organizations, and my project, which kind of came out of that in collaboration with my teaching at the New School and students there called Layered Spurra. So to give you a little snippet of this history, I thought it'd be useful to, so you can see there were a lot of buildings. There's not so many there. Its context that you can see here, the south of Grand Street were the first phase of the Seward Park urban renewal happened in the late 50s and actually was the sponsor for it was the United Housing Federation. And there are limited equity co-ops for ILGWU workers. So kind of based in a labor union, moderate income ownership model. And the second phase of this was meant to be rental properties for low and middle income. What happened is this. It's still there. And we can talk a little bit about what's happening now as well. But I wanted to kind of walk you through the history in a way that I do with people in the site itself. One of the things that I find really helpful to do is to talk about this when you're actually in the space. So we're not actually there, but I wanted to walk you through it. I made a series of guided tours of cards, basically, that are kind of the cheat sheet for understanding why this physical space is the way it is. And so these Layered Spurra cards kind of walk us through a little bit of the different parts of history that kind of come in and explain why Spurra is the way it is. So here's one of them. So if we were walking around, I would ask one of you to read this card. But I will read it for you. So this is a challenging concept and design for redevelopment and urban renewal is proposed in the Seward Park Urban Extension Urban Renewal Project. The chief objective of this concept is to renew the area physically while maintaining its social, economic, and visual continuity with the surrounding community, while still serving a broad range of low and middle-income families. This is promotional copy for Spurra from the 1960s. It bumped into this. You might be familiar with this and this guy. Except for one old man, I've been unable to find anyone of technical competence who's for this so-called expressway. I think we all know who he's talking about. So one of the complications and one of the histories that Spurra bumped into was Lomax and kind of the Robert Moses view of reimagining downtown. Short story of what happened is that in 1967, this space was taken for urban renewal and the buildings there condemned. Many people were displaced. It was about 1,800 families, most of whom were people of color, most of whom were low income. They were all promised that they could return. Very little was actually built. This is the only thing that was actually built in the first phase because the original sponsor, the UHF, actually pulled out. So NYCHA became the first sponsor to actually build anything at Spurra. But it bumped into a lot of problems. One of which was this non-honoring of the promise for original residents to return. And so we can look at Spurra and think about the ways in which things have changed there over the course of time. So the charge was racial discrimination in the renting of the original NYCHA houses that were, apartments that were built there. What happened was that community residents did a sit-in in the rental office and also brought a class action lawsuit, which significantly changed the way that housing was allocated and also the way that housing was allocated in future buildings that were built on the site. So suffice to say, not enough buildings were built, not enough space was built for people to return. So it brings us through 40 years of really complicated fights about affordable housing and what the future of that affordability could be to the Spur Matters project, which was this collaboration between Goals, Place Matters, the Pratt Center, and a whole coalition of other neighborhood-based organizations that wanted to think about, well, how could we start this conversation without response to a plan? So part of what we did was to have a series of visioning sessions and conversations that tried to get people talking in a way that tried to get kind of community conversation in a way that said, your voices matter in terms of what you think should happen in this place. The conversations here need to actually happen because in a place that has been extraordinarily divided across class and racial lines, there needs to be spaces outside of the space of kind of a community board meeting where people stand up and make presentations and then walk away. There needs to be a space of conversation. So this series of visioning sessions, the research that was done, all of these try to make different kinds of spaces available for kind of even just to get people talking, who it seems like a small thing, but at Spurra, people could barely talk to each other without shouting. So this process and the Layered Spurra exhibitions really sought to do that. So I'm gonna talk a little bit about this, and I know I have very little time, but these exhibitions really sought to, what I did with my students was to kind of give them a charge of saying, well, how can you make visual work that tries to open up the conversations, tries to pose questions rather than pose solutions? So we had a series of four exhibitions. These are from a bunch of different ones over the course from 2008 to 2012. And all of the work really tried to say, how can we look at both its history, its imagined futures, and make space for people who come to these exhibitions to talk? And one of the things that our community collaborators always talked about was the fact that they'd never actually seen some of these people who would come to our exhibition openings standing in the same room together without shouting at each other. And you know, just getting to that place was a benefit. This was one of the final ones that was kind of brought it outside of the neighborhood. And in 2012, when this kind of Spurra was kind of coming to more prominence as a citywide issue, not just something that was in the neighborhood. So this is where we are today, and one of the things I just want to leave you with is kind of, you know, part of what those conversations spurred was an investment by the city in kind of facilitated community board process to develop an RFP, and there's lots of complicated things about that we could talk about as well, but I think that was a very unusual process that came from this more ground-up kind of conversation. This last project is from this year's class that I taught, and it really poses this question that we're thinking about now, is kind of what happens in between, and also what happens as we go forward. So the thing that I'd like to leave you with is, how can the conversation stay open at Spurra so that this place can change as needed? Because I think it probably does need to change. And sure, Spurra, I would say, shows one thing extraordinarily clearly. That grand plans don't always happen as imagined, and we need a way to keep that conversation happening. So, thank you very much.
The next speaker is Benjamin from ANHD, also a group that we frequently work with at HPD. So, welcome, Benjamin.
Hi, good morning. My name is Benjamin Dolchin, and I'm neither a planner nor an architect, and I don't come with pretty things to show you. I'm a community organizer, and so we don't really have visuals, but we gesticulate wildly to try to liven up what we say. So I'll just gesticulate wildly, and hopefully that'll be as interesting. I'm the executive director of the Association for Neighborhood and Housing Development, which is the umbrella organization of about 101 neighborhood-based affordable housing groups across the city, really sort of the heart of the community development movement in the city, organizations that both for the last 30 years have been central to the city's plans to build affordable housing, really kind of catalyzing the creation of a lot of the city's tools to reinvest and to build a lot of the housing at a time when both the city and the private sector were walking away in the late 70s and early 80s when there were so many distressed neighborhoods. And then many member organizations are also groups that work a lot on neighborhood revitalization, tenants' rights and general affordable housing policy issues, recognizing that what is key to community development isn't just that the neighborhood kind of have the tools to do the bricks and mortar work or even the services, but also that the neighborhood is able to really set the policy landscape that the decision makers have to respond to it and have a strong role in that. So we sort of really try to combine those two things. What I've been asked to talk about today, and what I think is really interesting about this conversation, under this umbrella of stabilizing neighborhoods in the context of, the mayor's really exciting housing plan, what we've been asked to respond to is sort of three specific questions. What's worked? What conditions made it possible? And then kind of what does my case study point us to for going forward? So what I would talk about sort of for what's worked kind of broadly is this notion that what has been really sort of unique and distinctive about the way New York City has approached affordable housing development has been both that we've done it at a scale that is beyond what any city has imagined doing, right? I mean, so in the last 30 years, New York City has, through public subsidy, bringing private capital to the table, has built or preserved about 350,000 units of affordable housing in all five boroughs. This is not including any of the nitrogen development, but this is purely through the city catalyzed type of developments, beginning with the Koch plan, sort of what we think of as the sort of the new modern era of great New York City housing plans. So both the scale at which we did it was extraordinary, beyond really what any other city has done. We have the most technically capable and ambitious community development movement in the country, but also the careful local way in which it was done with really modern tools. So what we have in New York City and what has really been sort of quite sort of distinct in how long they have remained vibrant is neighborhood-based organizations, not-for-profit neighborhood-based affordable housing developers, CDCs, community development corporations, that were the key ones that in the 70s and 80s started out often as scrappy neighborhood organizations that were organizing apartment by apartment, building by building, and block by block in those neighborhoods that were most distressed, that were most facing abandonment and displacement pressures. And those organizations kind of forced the Koch administration to come to the table and take on these large challenges. But then they themselves developed the skills to be some of the very important first affordable housing developers. These neighborhood-based not-for-profit developers in the last 25 years have actually built about 100,000 units of affordable housing. But more importantly, and I think this is what I want to talk to, that for these organizations, neighborhood stabilization really isn't just about affordable housing. It's not just about the bricks and mortar development of a piece of affordable housing that is permanently affordable, which is a key distinction for what not-for-profit affordable housing developers do, that housing doesn't expire, but also that they really have a much more kind of comprehensive view of neighborhood stabilization and how neighborhood residents build a civic infrastructure that engages in the shaping the future of their neighborhood, and that does that in a way which both really gets to some really critical, to sort of some critical importance of high-level issues, but does so in a continually effective and productive way. So I just want to sort of give an example I want to talk about. Cypress Hills Local Development Corporation, just to kind of give an example, which I think is sort of a particularly interesting example for us because they are in many ways not primarily an affordable housing group. So they're an organization, although they do a lot of affordable housing. Cypress Hills Local Development is a community development corporation, actually an LDC, a local development corporation, that began in 1983. In the Cypress Hills, East New York part of Brooklyn, at a time when that neighborhood was sort of in the throes of the crack epidemic and was really, really distressed. And particularly in the Cypress Hills part of the neighborhood, there were a lot of sort of changes. There was lots of crime, an older white ethnic population was moving out. There was a younger, largely Puerto Rican population moving in, and there was really sort of a neighborhood, there was really a moment of both, you know, social problems and real kind of dislocation within the neighborhood. The Cypress Hills came together actually at the behest of a city program, came together at the City Human Rights Commission, had something called the Neighborhood Stabilization Program, which tried to pull together neighborhood actors to take on some of the key issues. And Cypress Hills is actually an example of where that happened. Starting in 1983, they sort of got together around these issues, and a bunch of neighborhood residents and activists working with the city's neighborhood stabilization program really sort of recognized kind of three key issues as the thing that was the kind of the mobilizing thing for them. So one was bank redlining. There were lots of the neighborhood lenders were simply drawing a red line around parts of that neighborhood and just refusing to lend there. Housing abandonment, kind of as a result of the increasingly poor neighborhood population and the lack of bank lending. Lots of the housing was falling into severe disrepair or actually being abandoned because landlords couldn't get loans. And then blockbusting, where real estate agents and developers were manipulating the racial dynamics of the neighborhood to try to encourage longer-term residents to sell out quickly and cheaply so that they could buy their houses. So that was, you know, sort of one of the catalysts, and sort of the key thing they began to work on initially was a commercial revitalization along the Fulton Street corridor, where a lot of the small businesses, because of the shifting demographics and because of the open-air drug markets, were closing and really sort of creating a lot of anxiety in the neighborhood without, you know, with that commercial corridor being distressed. You know, they began to work on these issues and, you know, did a lot of work first around drugs, you know, sort of combating the drug markets, you know, working with the 75th Precinct, bringing the Community Patrol Officer Program. But from that, you know, from that sort of initial beginning, built up a broader approach to the neighborhood and sort of began adding on program by program to really kind of take on the next thing that was going to be the critical issue, the critical threat, or the critical opportunity for that neighborhood. You know, they're an organization that has 90 full-time employees. They've got about 300 part-time employees with a lot of the youth services work that they do. They have, over the last number of years, built 400 units of affordable housing, which is permanently affordable, and scattered around the neighborhood, which is no easy thing to do. They do a lot of economic development work, and in particular recently, they've begun to focus, sort of expand beyond just their commercial revitalization work to really pay attention to the light manufacturing zoned, M1 zoned areas, sort of in the heart of their neighborhood, and recognizing the kind of physically unattractive but economically really important light metal fabrication industry there as a key source of economic stability and opportunity for a lot of their residents, and sort of the need to have an advocacy and a policy voice to preserve that as part of the neighborhood. And then they do a lot of youth services and a lot of education work and actually built the Cypress Hills Community School and have had sort of a long-term, multi-year effort around organizing neighborhood parents to open and demand better schools. The key lessons for this, I think, and sort of, you know, why this matters, is that I think here you have an example, and this is one example, but there are, you know, many of these good organizations around the city, there's sort of many neighborhoods around the city that have the benefit of this type of organization, that sort of have affordable housing development as a key part of what they do, and they do it quite well. And they do it permanently affordable, but where they really see an ecosystem of neighborhood needs, where you have a neighborhood organization that's standing there in the middle, that has both the technical sophistication, but also because they have a local board, has the interest in sort of taking on the issues that are confronting that neighborhood, sort of where and when those issues arise. So beginning with crime, but then realizing that they needed to go into housing because the market otherwise wouldn't function, recognizing now that economic development is really key, and is able to sort of nimbly and flexibly really kind of channel the community's interests and concerns to shape the forces that are shaping their neighborhood. And this is sort of a uniquely effective thing at making a neighborhood that doesn't have just new affordable housing units that are created, as important as that is, but that creates those units in a way where it's part of an ecosystem of shaping a stronger sort of civic, social, and service infrastructure to really stabilize that neighborhood and help it to, you know, to both grow as it needs to do, but to grow in a way where you're actually helping the local population to be able to stay and be sort of part of what will hopefully be sort of a thriving neighborhood future rather than face displacement pressures. So, you know, and the reason I think this is sort of so key and the lessons for this today is that this happened because government policy sort of encouraged this to happen and recognized the value of that. And there is a lot of concern that sort of city housing policy really kind of no longer recognizes the importance of that and is very focused on efficient unit development, which is a hugely important thing and is an absolutely crucial part of how affordable housing needs to develop, but has also kind of lost sight of the very important and appropriate role of neighborhood-based developers as kind of a key anchor to both be able to build the housing, but also to sort of form the core civic institution that can have more sort of more broadly strengthen the neighborhood. And this is actually one of the key challenges then, of the de Blasio housing plan, which we are, you know, very, very excited about, which is ambitious, you know, sort of beyond anything we had hoped for. But in talking about those 200,000 units, I think they're, for us, the goal is not 200,000 units. The goal is that in 10 years, there be stronger neighborhoods, more affordable neighborhoods, neighborhoods where the population is better able to sort of stay and be secure. Maybe 200,000 units is the right number to reach for. Perhaps it's not, right? Perhaps it's a lower number of units, but that are developed in the right way and in a balance that really sort of better stabilizes that neighborhood. So I guess what I would argue is to sort of to hang on to make sure that sort of some of the uniquely strong things and uniquely strong institutions that we developed over the years are sort of a central part of the way that we continue to think about the development of affordable housing.
This is amazing. I mean, the exciting part about hearing these speakers, I'm sitting there thinking that all of this stuff is like, are you talking to me right now? Because it's exactly what I think about every day. So this is great stuff. So, the next speaker is Paula Siegel. Please welcome Paula.
So I think I've been asked to speak here today as part of a conversation about stabilizing neighborhoods and what's possible, because I know something about the power and potential of collective action, about the doors that are unlocked when you can say clearly to New Yorkers, you can change your city. Here's how to take the first step. I'm the director of 596 Acres, New York's three-year-old community land access advocacy organization. We've helped 32 groups around New York City transform the incomprehensible vacant lots in their neighborhoods into thriving community spaces, some for the long term, some for as long as the land is available before another project moves forward. Just this week, a small green patch, which was a thriving space for 4 years that we facilitated on an HPD-owned property on Bergen Street between 3rd and 4th Avenue here in Gowanus, Brooklyn, closed its gates in anticipation of a rental housing development to be constructed on the same site. Next week, we're opening the Bangladeshi American Community Youth Service, Bangladeshi American Community and Youth Service Community Garden. We're going to learn to say that. In East New York, which is on the A-train tunnel roof. Our process starts with researching and stating what's possible in the simplest terms. Vacant land in our neighborhoods is an issue of social injustice, the artifact of redlining, municipal neglect, and the targeting of neighborhoods where people of color live and work for renewal in the form of bulldozing and reduced density and new construction, or sometimes just one of those steps and then a lot of waiting. Today, I'm here to highlight a few other things that are possible that address more structural changes for that address the more structural challenges for inclusion at the scale of the vacant lot and beyond. Specifically, I'm going to talk about the potential for cooperative real estate investment and community land trusts. both proven models to stabilize our neighborhoods and make sure that New Yorkers have not only the open space they need, but also affordable places to work, to shop, to eat together, and of course, to live. We all know that whoever controls the land controls our neighborhood economies, and all too often, those forces have interests outside of our neighborhoods themselves. To confront this, we are in the process of establishing a real estate investment cooperative model that will allow us to leverage small investments made by large groups of people to purchase properties that we think are crucial and protect them from speculation by placing them into community land trusts. A community land trust is a not-for-profit organization that's accountable to the community and organized with the single mission of holding land. Such trusts are simple to form under New York State law, and we have several in New York City. The Cooper Square Community Land Trust on the Lower East Side holds the land beneath 21 buildings in what was designated the Cooper Square Urban Renewal Area in 1959 and slated for demolition. The Brooklyn-Queens Land Trust holds 34 community gardens, 32 acquired as part of the settlement of the state's lawsuit against the city when then-Mayor Rudy Giuliani attempted to auction these and dozens of other gardens. These are our local and familiar examples, but around the country there are over 260 others, most organized to maintain affordable homeownership and rental properties. Since a community land trust's single mission is to hold the land and keep it accessible and affordable for the uses the community desires, that mission can never come into conflict with the needs of other programming. The land is never in danger of being viewed as an asset that can be sold to meet the organization's other goals, since the organization that holds the land has no other goals. Of course, other people and organizations can use the land and own structures, buildings and homes and businesses on top of the land. The big difference between any land trust or any other not-for-profit organization that holds land and a community land trust is the makeup of its board. Generally, one-third of the board are users of the land or other direct beneficiaries. One-third are community members who are impacted by how the land is used. And one-third are uninvolved individuals who have a stake in keeping the land affordable. With such a makeup, there can never be a self-interested majority that decides that the value of the property on the market is greater than its local use value. Keeping the CLT in mind is the goal. We're working to set up an investment mechanism with a slow rate of return, patient capital, that will allow lots of people to become investors in the physical infrastructure of our communities, investors in the stability of our neighborhoods, and investors in the city they want to stay in. It's modeled on similar investment cooperatives in Minneapolis and Toronto, both of which build on structures used by farming communities to invest in infrastructure, equipment, land, and marketing. Here in New York City, in just 10 days, over 300 people pledged over $1 million towards investing in New York City. There are lots of different reasons that people want to get involved. The idea of a real estate cooperative is that no matter how much you invest, you get one vote. You get one vote to decide how that money will be used. And that leveling of the playing field is something I think New Yorkers are really hungry for. We want to put our money where we put our most sincere love and efforts. We want to benefit by having a city in which the places we care about endure and in which we prosper and stay. Here's one example of a place we can lose, a community center that supports over 300 canners who make sure that our bottles and cans actually go back to their manufacturers as mandated by the bottle bill. This is the place where these folks work. We need the help of everyone in this room and the help of the city. We need city support for cooperative capital, not just generic support for development. We need the city to prioritize the disposition of our public land to community land trusts that can serve our neighborhoods in perpetuity, not just by producing a number of units in the next 10 years or 30 years. We need to think with a long horizon. If you'd like to work with us to create a structure for cooperative real estate investment in New York City, please join us on April 28th in the evening on East 1st Street at the Howell Art Space in the Cooper Square Community Land Trust neighborhood. We know it's possible for New Yorkers as investors in their own city to be a collective stabilizing force. We know this from the history of housing cooperatives, from our community gardens, and from our millions of miles of shared infrastructure. We are born to do this. Let's keep going.
So how much time, are you the timekeeper? Okay, so let me keep my eyes on you while we're doing this, but we're just gonna bring it up to a few questions here for the panelists, and then we're gonna open up to questions for you guys, and there's microphones, is that right? Okay. So let me find my questions. So you guys have amazing experience, amazing history, amazing expertise, and a lot of stuff, so I kinda wanna take you out of your own world for a little bit, and actually play mayor for a day. So what I thought was, you know, you all brought a perspective about the way that we think about home and that we think about neighborhoods and home in neighborhoods or neighborhood as home and the equity and diversity within neighborhoods, whether it's from ownership or just having quality rental units, buildings, and how that gets developed with people. So if you were mayor for a day, what neighborhoods would you choose to actually do the neighborhood planning throughout the city? He chose six neighborhoods. They were published in his State of the City speech. Would you have chosen those same neighborhoods, or would you choose others, and why?
All right, I'll fling myself.
And the reason I ask these questions is because they're ones that we ask every day, and we hear, like, why did they choose those, and why didn't they do this, and what was the message that they're trying to get out to us? And so anyway.
So that is an incredibly interesting and incredibly contentious question. I think there's sort of two ways to think about that, right? And so I suspect that there's sort of two ways that the city let me sort of first say how we think the city has chosen these neighborhoods, right? So we know there's going to be 15 neighborhoods that the city is going to be rezoning, which is really a key part of incentivizing the private market to function at a really high level so that the mayor can both get more units built across the city, because of a growing population, totally appropriate, and also make sure that we're extracting a meaningful number of affordable units from all that new development. I guess we sort of think that the mayor sort of looked at it in two ways. And by the mayor, I probably mean you, since you're probably the one who's actually been doing a lot of the thinking, but here's how we sort of understood it. The 10,000 feet sort of, you know, planner look of, like, where are the neighborhoods where there is, you know, sort of low density that is, you know, sort of low, that is sort of has a lot of transportation, is near a transportation hub, where from kind of a pure planner network, from a pure planner point of view, it looks to us that this is an appropriate place to upzone and get a lot of affordable housing built. And then they've kind of overlaid that with what turns out to largely be low-income neighborhoods of color that don't have a lot of political capital, who are more likely to, you know, sort of, you know, have a quick process because they have less political capital. And that's an understandable way to sort of, that's an understandable set of choices to make, because planning rezoning is a really contentious thing. But may well be appropriate for the first six neighborhoods. I think we would hope that that's not going to be the sort of the same for the rest of the neighborhoods. And I think particularly as we look at what we think is going to be a key tool of mandatory inclusionary zoning, which, you know, will really be a sort of an important way of getting that affordable housing built, but really only happens when the private market works to build a lot of market rate housing. And that's not going to happen in those lower income neighborhoods. That's going to happen in those higher income neighborhoods, that where it's both appropriate to have a new density, but also where you are not afraid of the displacement pressures that are going to occur there. And that's going to be both, that is more tricky from a political point of view than it is from a planning point of view. So
do you have an alternative six neighborhoods or other neighborhoods? Or
how would you have a couple neighborhoods? So, you know, there's parts of the Upper East Side that are probably quite under dense. There's certainly parts of, you know, sort of, you know, in downtown and sort of lower Brooklyn towards the river, where we'd have less displacement impacts, but where you have, you know, not the density that you could have. There's probably parts of sort of, you know, out along sort of Ocean Parkway, there's parts of the neighborhood there. So it's a conversation we would love to have, actually.
Good. Anyone else have a comment on that?
Yeah. So I would answer that question by taking the focus away from the rezoning and really focus on neighborhood-based planning and look carefully at where our shared assets already are. There is lots of existing vacant public land in our neighborhoods that could be serving our neighborhoods, but instead is waiting for the private development market to take an interest in those properties. And I think we should be looking comprehensively at the opportunities that those assets, whether they're vacant lots or municipal buildings that are shut down or other pieces of infrastructure that aren't being used, and we should be looking at how those can serve the city, not in terms of producing units this year or in the next 10 years as the housing plan projects, but how they can serve the city for the long term, longer than the Mitchell-Lama program, really in perpetuity. So I would start with the neighborhoods where those assets are concentrated, and I would start with planning for those assets. And I can name some neighborhoods if you want.
Rather than the rezoning is the reason why we're going out the door.
I would just say that even though there was a kind of a lot of controversy over the former administration's plans around building on parts of NYCHA developments, I think that there needs to be a less sort of strident conversation about the way in which land is actually used in NYCHA developments across the city, and the whole question of parking lots in Manhattan and other places. I think that that's a discussion about sustainability. There are ways to frame it. I think there is an enormous amount of underutilized land in the NYCHA portfolio, and it's across all boroughs, and it's across a wide range of neighborhoods in terms of income, location, et cetera. So I think that should definitely be a sort of conversation about what kind of neighborhoods we want these places to be, what neighborhoods want this to be in the long term.
So again, if you were mayor for the day, and you were able to oversee not only HPD, but mainly HPD and the resources that we have and the tools that we have, what one to three priority tools, as Benjamin sort of said, that the city has available to it, tools or approaches or policies would you want to see out the door, particularly right now, to implement the housing plan, to not only fulfill production that's in the housing plan, but also to create diverse and economically diverse neighborhoods? One to three priority policies, tools, approaches.
I can be brief, but I can tell you, going back to the old precedent, which was to go out there and look for sponsors again. I mean, to look for a wider range of develop. I mean, I know we talked about the community development corporations and so forth, but it's worth opening up and looking for, calling for sponsors in terms of the cooperative model, looking for a whole new sort of generation of sponsors, people to talk about cooperative housing. And I mean, I think it's a tremendous opportunity. The co-housing thing never really took off in New York because of the capital requirements, but it has been successful in other cities. So I think there is a generation to be very interested in this idea.
I mean, I think one thing that I would add to this is kind of the things that I've learned from working at Spura is really thinking about, well, how do you step back and say, to try and do community-based planning that actually asks what the questions are before you sort of are putting forth the idea that the number of units is what we need to do. I mean, certainly the idea of more housing is necessary, but I think I might suggest that there be more of a focus on trying to ask to define the questions collaboratively in communities. Even if you say those are the whatever 15 neighborhoods that you're going to work in, if the process steps back and says, well, how do we actually define the questions in those places, rather than saying we know the answers, we just want to find out how we should get to them better. It sounds vague, but I think it's a really different kind of shift to thinking about how do you actually do planning, and a kind of shift on the role of expertise and kind of who holds expertise on what should happen in neighborhoods.
Yes.
And can I speak to that? So just to go right directly from that, the city should be more responsive to who holds expertise in the most simple mechanical tools that it has available. Specifically, the city makes land available for $1 to developers who promise to stay within broad program guidelines that basically state you will build something that we can call affordable housing. I think that we could get a lot more specific, and we could be asking those entities that get free land, our free land, to be the ones that are the most engaged, and the ones that are the most engaged not in producing units right now so they can turn a profit, but the most engaged in the long-term stability of our neighborhoods. And that's a simple policy change we can make now, and every single parcel of city-owned land that goes for a dollar to a for-profit developer this year is an opportunity that we've lost.
So just building a little bit on that. So if you were advising the mayor, if you weren't the mayor but were advising the mayor, what's the message or the forum out the door that you would do to create a working with a relationship with people like yourselves, advocates in the room? We're a city, right? So this is, I mean, and I've always been on this side, but now I'm on this side for a little while. So we're a city, we are a bureaucracy, and we represent stuff in people's minds. What is our message out the door to better engage community advocates, neighborhoods, in ways that identifies problems, rather than us just getting problems as you defined them, but that we actually sort of identify the concerns together and the solutions together?
So I think that, I mean, this sort of gets to the process question. I think we're, DCP, I assume, is sort of really gun-shy about genuinely engaging the community around neighborhood zoning, because it's always such a contentious process, right? Even when it works well, oh, it's so contentious. And there's a lot of really well-intentioned people out there, and there's some, frankly, less well-intentioned people out there. And so it's a complicated process. But nonetheless, we need to move forward with this. And so having a process that is, I think, a little more open, at least in the beginning, than DCP would like it to have. I mean, I think there is genuinely concern among a lot of the sort of the neighborhood folks working on this that the process that the mayor is sort of, hopes to improve is one that sort of, frankly, kind of goes through the motions of engaging the community, but doesn't really. And I think we recognize the difficulties that the city faces in really getting stuff done in what is going to always be a contentious, intense process. But I guess we do think that there's a way of starting it where there's sort of a common set of assumptions that we can all kind of work off that recognizes that there is going to be kind of a give and take balance between the amount of a new house, the amount of affordable house, the amount of open space, sort of dealing with transportation, and that there's a way for the community to have a process that sort of sets out what are its, five or six core priorities in kind of weighted balance, and then the city kind of respects those core priorities, and then that then becomes kind of the common document that then starts the process.
Yeah.
But that if the city knows that the city is recognized, if the community knows that the city is sort of recognizing that as the legitimate starting point for what is then a tense back and forth over the next 9 months, right. I think that would take a lot of the venom out of the room.
Yeah. Agreed.
I think there's also sort of, this is not the message, but this is kind of the three things that I would love to see sort of shift in the process, and part of this builds on kind of what Paula was talking about in terms of ideas about, well, how do we define affordable? I think defining affordable to be actually affordable would be nice, right? I mean, the idea that we have affordability in this city, the idea of kind of legislating affordability based on AMI just doesn't work across the city. It doesn't work across all neighborhoods in the city. And I think being real about that and grappling with it would really address the issue seriously. And I think, and would be kind of towards this idea of being sincerely upfront about what we mean. And kind of going towards this idea of also kind of clarifying language. One thing that I notice very frequently in every community board meeting or any kind of presentation by any city agency is there is a huge disconnect between kind of normal language and the language of planning, and not just the language of planning, but the kind of ways in which acronyms and policy is complex. It's certainly not something to say that it's not, but there are ways of making that more accessible, of not explicitly trying to make it more difficult. And I think there are ways in which maybe sometimes to avoid kind of a more confrontational situation that we use language as a tool or a barrier. And I would say that is a key part of thinking about the ways in which kind of community collaboration actually happens or could happen, or trust could be really built. And lastly, I would say if we're talking seriously about affordable housing, that idea of perpetuity is, that is a core concept. I mean, that idea is so crucial, and it's, that the lack of that is something that's why we're partially in the crisis that we're in right now, because so much has aged out. So to really kind of anchor all of this in that clearly all the time.
So is defining affordability, clarifying language, what was the third one?
Defining affordability, perpetuity.
Oh, the perpetuity question.
Accessibility of language.
Yep.
And so we only have.
Can I answer
go ahead.
That?
I'm just concerned that we have only a few more minutes, and I want to make sure we get a few people. But if you
so out the door instead of talking about upzoning, build assets and institutions in the neighborhoods that you might upzone that make it possible for people to stay and make them proud to stay. Mm-hmm. The Toronto waterfront, I just learned, is building a whole new neighborhood, and they're upzoning the entire waterfront. But what they've done first is build 23 acres of park. It is a neighborhood where zero people live right now. They've built 23 acres of parkland for people in Toronto to enjoy, so that someday when people do live in that neighborhood, there are parks. And I think that that is a model that we could really follow, especially in neighborhoods that are low-density residential neighborhoods where people are feeling like there is great scarcity.
Density
and
open space, right.
Yeah, and lead with those.
Assets, building assets. Yes, sir.
Ron Schiffman, a couple of quick comments. First of all, I think one has to recognize that displacement and speculation around land has become palpable in every community in the city of New York. So in order to move ahead, I think the city has really got to make a statement on what they're going to do to protect neighborhoods from displacement, because that, until you can deal with that fear, then you can't get into a rational discussion with people. I think that's really important. The other thing is that we have to recognize, and I think Ben started building the case, that a lot of the public policy that we all are looking at in the past that was successful came about because community-based organizations actually fought for the changes in local government and local policies. It's the work that 596 is doing and others are doing that really went towards that. Cooperatives and a lot of the other efforts led to public initiatives under the Koch administration through sweat equity programs that then led to the community-based development movement that involved some of the cooperatives that then went a long way. We've got to start thinking about this, not from zoning, but from planning. I think that was a message that we heard here.
Yeah.
And one way of doing this would be, to my mind, by the mayor not announcing numbers or continuing to focus on numbers, but convening the community-based organizations and convening the community boards throughout the city and asking them, how would you address fundamentally what really is the affordable and low-income housing needs of the city of New Yorkers, and ask them to, from a community base up, on how to address that issue rather than a top-down. And finally, I think we have to disavow some of the myths. Public housing land exists, and some of it could be developed, but not all of it. Mm-hmm. Some of it were because of towers in the parks. You don't want to remove those parks. Some of that we learned during Sandy. We need to manage water more properly, and we need that open space in communities. And we shouldn't only look at public housing lands, but let's look at some of the wealthier communities in the city. Let's start economically integrating them first, and then we'll be able to economically integrate low-income communities. And I think we really have to start thinking about this, not in the segregationist way that New York City has been looking at it, but how we can really build one city and do it through a community planning process.
Thank you. So it's time for me to wrap up. If I could just take 1 minute, I want to say that this is an honor to actually hear these recommendations and participate here on the panel, because what I want to communicate when I feel like my job is however long that I'll be in this office, it's a moment in my career too. And I feel like if there's anything that I can do to be an advocate for there was nothing that I did have not that I heard that I disagree with and that I don't actually say myself. So if you hear me using the words that you just spoke, I'll credit you, but there are also ones that I speak daily too within the office. I'm at 100 Gold Street. It's a city agency, and the connection to neighborhoods is critical for me. And I'm trying to figure out the best way to do that. Partners at Pratt and ANHD are the partners that sort of are helping me do that, and I need to, and I guess what I'm saying is making a stronger commitment that, you know, if I look back at the end of this year, what I would hope to achieve is exactly what Ron just sort of talked about, is how can we make the better bridge and the better connection so that we're actually saying these things and doing these things in a meaningful way. So thank you for
allowing me to participate on this panel with you and in the audience. Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much to our first panel. I'd like to invite up the moderator for our second panel, Meredith Tenhor, who's from Pratt Institute.
Thank you all for coming, and to Karen and Bill for putting together this incredible event. I think all the panelists can come up now. So this panel is going to be talking about quality and design. So we heard a lot about policy in the last panel and how policy is an important element to making better neighborhoods and better forms of housing. And it seems, in spite of, or in the face of all of those challenges, I don't know, almost a little bit trivial to speak about design, but I think it's actually quite crucial. And so what I think we're going to do in this panel is to talk about the ways in which design quality has an impact on the success of different projects. So in the late 1960s, as cities nationwide were considered to be in crisis, design was often blamed for the failure of public housing. Pruitt-Igoe is probably the most famous case in point. And it might be, in a way, a symptom of the desire to kind of make design into a scapegoat for a series of other policy-based decisions which impact the success of housing in a pretty pointed way. So we know that we need, from that case, better maintenance, less restrictive policing, and better funding to make housing a success. So all of these elements have to be in place for successful public housing, but that doesn't mean that design doesn't matter. Quality can be made an enormous impact in the design of houses. And so our panelists today are going to be talking about quality across different time periods. Our first panelist, Professor Menking, who teaches here at Pratt, is going to be talking about Sunnyside Gardens, a project that was developed in Queens in the 1920s. Suzanne Schindler, who's a research scholar at the Temple Hoyne Buell Center for the Study of American Architecture at Columbia University, is going to be talking about the Twin Parks development in the 1970s. And David Burney, who's a professor here at Pratt and leader of our new program in placemaking, is going to be talking about some of the turnkey projects that were produced in Manhattan, I think specifically East 84th Street, in the decades that followed. So thank you all for coming, and thank you to our panelists.
Okay, thank you, Meredith. That was a wonderful introduction, connecting the dots between policy and physical nature of design. As Meredith said, this panel is asking itself the question, or looking at what works in housing in New York City and why, what defines quality, and what conditions made these possible. And Sunnyside Gardens, which I'm going to speak about, really does all of those. It's in the past been criticized by some for being anti-urban. We'll talk about that in a second. It's maybe a fair criticism. But the creators of it were looking at New York at a very different time and a very different set of conditions. They really came out of the 19th century, thinking back to Richard Plenz's question about the 20th century not answering the questions presented by the 19th. These figures believe that they were doing that, but still held many ideas that today we would see as being somewhat passé. But they did believe, for example, that poverty was caused by the city. I mean, I think today we would look at public policy issues, political issues, for answers to why poverty exists, but these figures really like pointed right at the city. You know, they came out of the early founding of city planning. Many of the members of this group that created Sunnyside Gardens were at the very first city planning conference at the University of Liverpool. They were adherents of Raymond Unwin and Barry Parker's Ebenezer Howard town plans in Great Britain. So, you know, they came out of a different time and a different generation. They came together during World War I when the federal government asked a group of people to quickly gather and create housing for war workers in the run-up to World War I. The government also stipulated that when the war was over, that this group would be disbanded. And that brings up an issue that is constant in the history of housing in all the United States, which is that the private market has always viewed housing as its prerogative, and it does not really want the nonprofit world invading in that. And that's certainly the way the 1935 public housing legislation was created. As Catherine Bauer, one of the founders of that movement, pointed out in an article in 1948. So this comes and goes, this idea about, you know, the private market feeling that they can answer these problems, and of course they never really have. But these other groups intervene. So after World War I, this group of architects, early city planners, intellectuals, because Lewis Mumford was a member of that group, they gathered together to create the Regional Planning Association of America, what's called the RPAA. And in parenthesis, just to point out, to really complicate this history, we also in New York have the headquarters of the RPA, the Regional Planning Association. That is not the RPAA, and everything that the RPAA stood for, the RPA stands for something almost different. The RPA really believed in centralization when it first started. They believed in a strong midtown Manhattan to solve the problems of the city, whereas the RPAA believed just the opposite, that the problem of housing in New York was to sort of downzone, if you will, which was to create a new kind of neighborhood community that didn't look at Midtown Manhattan is the center. So this is something I think I need to point out. It was founded in 1923 after the war. They all got back together. And interestingly enough, since some of them were architects, they really played out their arguments in the pages of the AIA Journal, because Charles Whitaker, who was the head of the AIA at the time, really felt that planning and housing issues were right at the forefront of what architects needed to be looking at. So this housing movement was really played out in the primary architecture journal of the period. And the members included Clarence Stein, Henry Wright, who's sometimes called the other Wright in reference to Frank Lloyd, Alexander Bing, Benton McKay, who was a very important figure in this because, as you may know, he was the founder of the notion of the Appalachian Trail, this public works project that went from Maine and now ends up in Georgia, and that was very much a planning issue that came out of this. It's important here because the group really believed that one of the problems of the city was that its residents were out of contact with nature, and they wanted to bring nature into the project. They were, McKay was a sort of Connecticut Yankee who was raised in Western Connecticut and believed in this sort of almost Thoreauian idea about nature. So they wanted to bring nature back into the city. They built Sunnyside Gardens from like 1924 to 1930 with these kind of gardens that you see here. Here's an early image of it. I think I have a better plan of it right here. There you go. To bring nature into the city. What they were looking at was the existing city. There's a great book called The American City by Manfredo Tafuri and Francesco Dalco. And in there, Dalco points out that
for those of you, he says, who look at white walls and flat roofs as modern, this project will not seem modern, because what the developers of the project proposed was that modernism was about standards. It wasn't about the look of the building. It was about how much light and air you could bring into the building, how much open space you could provide for its residents. So they created this project that gave everyone a private garden right behind their house, and then this big open communal garden in the middle. That's why some people think it's anti-urban, because it gets rid of the historic association with the street in New York City. But again, they were aiming this for people who were living in tenements in Williamsburg and Greenpoint in the Lower East Side. That's who they meant it for. It was very much a model, so that they wanted the project to be affordable by people who were living in tenements, and they felt that they could give them this added advantage of the nature and be in the city. So they were able to get this property. There's what the architecture looks like. You don't see white walls there. They specifically built the project out of brick, because for them, as modernists, brick was the vernacular building material of New York City. And they wanted to be honest with materials. They didn't want to fake it. So this is why the project was built in this kind of way. So the project has been successful. There's still a waiting list to get in. Interestingly, I don't think it'll ever be gentrified, shall we say, although that's a misused word often. But it's still a project that's lived in by, you know, normal kind of people, and it has this incredibly high level of standards. We saw, those of on the tour yesterday, saw a bit of this at Brinkman Plaza in the South Bronx instituted, but I think in many respects, I'll just wrap up here, that this idea of bringing open, you know, space in proximity to housing in a way has been picked up in America in private gated communities where they're golf courses instead of open space, which would have been horrific to the members who started the RPAA, you know, because they believed in a communal space for everyone in the middle. But it has a lot to teach us. It's built fantastic quality. Jonathan Kirschfeld yesterday talked about brick and in his support of housing in the South Bronx, and this is really what this project was all about. It was about standards, it was about quality, and it was built and it worked. And the last thing I wanted to say that I can maybe answer in the questions is that it's really a part of what I call an American model of housing, where there is a philanthropic group, some government support for profit. In other words, the architects were making a profit, but it was all part of this combination, which I think is a very important idea to think about when we're thinking, considering housing in New York City, that there's a very specific way we do this kind of housing. It's different from Vienna, these other great cities with housing. We do it in our own kind of way, and this was one of those examples. So thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm going to follow also with a project built in brick, also vernacular, but at a different scale. It's located in the Bronx. It's called Twin Parks, not Twin Peaks, but if you can remember it better that way, remember it that way. It is a scattered site urban renewal project realized between 1967 and 1975. And I want to speak about this because it overcame certain oppositional pairs that I think we still think about today and which have come up in certain of the presentations so far. One is to think bottom-up as opposed to top-down, and I think that's a wrong fallacy. I think the bottom-up can't exist without the larger top-down, as I think actually even the case of the 1983 Local Development Corporation made clear. As I understood, it was prompted by the city, so there needs to be the big picture to support the low picture, but it needs to have the on the ground expertise who want something and advocate for it, but it has to be, there has to be another level to coordinate. And actually also think, sorry, I'm already commenting on the former thing, that the park in Toronto made that clear to me, that the park in Toronto was planned not for a community, it was planned for the city. So I don't think we can think neighborhood as distinct from city. And there are always people who are trying to get into community but are not there yet. So I think that big picture, small picture. It also, Twin Parks is both iconic in its architecture and contextual, i.e. it combines high-rise and low-rise. So I think those also have to be thought in together, especially when we're talking about density and upzoning. And the third thing is sort of a mix of uses, mix of incomes. I mean, that's become sort of standard fare, but how is that actually possible? So I'm partially interested in twin parks because for me, and I think several people in the room, between the mid-60s and the mid-70s, there was a window of opportunity where the belief government had to do something, had the money to do something, was willing to do it, and wasn't willing to engage in new models and engage new architectural models. So there was a belief in scale, but also in variety. I'm going to show a few pictures. My reading of this, not to be afraid of size. This is a building by Giovanni Pasanella. But also not to be afraid of maybe not the street edge. Not everything has to be in one model. So this is a pilotis that's totally out of fashion today, but why not? It might be actually quite a nice shaded space to sit in. This is a project on 180th Street by Polshek. The city is made up of contrasts, and I think we should embrace this to work with the city, but not to be afraid to engage mid, high rise, all the messiness that's involved, and also to think of private outdoor spaces. There's a variety of scales, and I think twin parks accomplish that. And just as a reminder, the city is a work in progress. This is what you see in the background, a building by Skidmore, Owings, Merrill, big SOM, big firm. They've purged that from their archive. They don't want to talk about it. concrete, prefabricated concrete experiments. That was a high rise. That was clearly different than the mid-rise tenement block, but also different from what was built in the 80s, which we would no longer do a three-story small-scale thing today. So our models keep changing, but I think we have to think that all together. So just quickly, Twin Parks, where it's located, it's somewhere between the high numbers of Co-op City and the contextualness of Melrose Commons. The scattered site, urban renewal. Two areas, Twin Parks East, Twin Parks West, with the identified sites. It was a direct effort to stabilize a neighborhood, originated in a group of religious congregations. It was not deemed particularly successful in stabilizing that neighborhood in the short term. And this is an overview, unfortunately not quite clear, but you see in the aerial, these are the projects that have actually been realized in the east and the west. Just a few numbers, 12 sites, 5 architects, over 2,000 apartments, between 0 and 5 bedrooms, that's another thing. There's actually a large scale difference. Low modern income and senior housing, all rental housing, 3 schools, 3 daycare centers, 1 youth center, a pool, and retail integrated with this planning. What made it possible? Three key points. So the bottom up and top down. New York State was a prominent player. I think they've sort of faded. They should come back. The Urban Development Corporation, the federal government, the city government, as well as this Twin Parks Association. So everything is needed to make this happen. This is taken from an advertisement for an apartment in Richard Meyer's Twin Parks Northeast. Again, the bottom up, that it was more than 15 churches and synagogues. They actually formed an association. They actually wanted to develop the housing themselves, but they were not able to, so they finally collaborated with the state agency. This is a picture taken from an Urban Development Corporation annual report. So again, people and numbers and projects. But that was also part of a larger planning. So again, my point, you have to think of the whole city and all the stakeholders and not just who's in a community at a certain moment. What worked? Again, iconic and contextual. I'm going to look at the projects by Giovanni Pasanella. This is a view of them, one of them on the left. In there, seen from street level, seen as a model view. So you see the whole area along Webster Avenue. You can see high rise, low rise, all integrated views from the time. Is this beautiful? I don't know. Is this quality design? I'm not sure. We can decide that. But going to the unit level, this was discussed at the time. This was clearly developed as an alternative to suburbia. And as published in the New York Times, these were split-level apartments, floor through, which enabled the living spaces on one side and the bedroom spaces on another. And the architect clearly articulated that as a split-level, that the model house that people have in the suburbs, he wants to make available to people in the city. then in terms of mixed use and mixed type, at the northern end of the Twin Parks West, a project by Prentice and Chan Olhausen with landscape architect Terry Schnadelbach. Again, the street view, where you see, look down the street, it actually looks completely contextual, but it's a large-scale project that straddles a 60-foot embankment, creates a shared courtyard space in the middle. Get a sense of how that in section, how that drop is negotiated, and how on Webster Avenue it's actually much much higher. Sense of the courtyard space, so picking up on the need for landscaping and outdoor shared spaces, a few images from the time. What can we learn for today from this? And I'm going to talk about what didn't work so well. And maybe the one thing that I haven't pointed out, that the difficult relationship between the private sector and the public sector. So this was the UDC funded everything, hired the architects, made it happen, but it was premised on an idea that Twin Parks, that the projects would be managed and operated privately from the beginning. This is Richard Meyer's project. It's three buildings on three adjacent blocks. Did you go on the tour yesterday? Did you stop there? Okay. Again, if you look at street level, it's actually quite integrated. It was much discussed at the time, published widely internationally and not, and as you can see, it that's the axonometric of those three buildings, high-rise and mid-rise, and the key feature was it closed off one block of street to create a public plaza for the community. The idea was to stabilize the community and let not only residents but everybody congregate there. Unfortunately, it immediately led to the gang warfare happening right there, and so everything's been closed off with fences ever since. But I'm going to look at three features to talk about the question of design and quality of design, and that essentially it depends on how it's managed. If you look at that, that's a rooftop community space with a terrace. Today it looks like this from the inside. It's been entirely cinder blocked. There's no access to the outside. If you look at the originally here, the plaza with a single loaded corridor, daylit corridor, large windows. That single loaded corridor facade has been entirely blocked for security reasons, probably also maintenance reasons. And so from the inside, it's dark with the exception of one window in that long hallway. Third feature are these outdoor spaces, smaller plazas and larger ones. They've also been, they're all fenced in, essentially. So is that something that worked or not? I think there's potential there. I think that we should embrace and revisit some of those features. And I think we should always think design in conjunction with management, ownership, funding, top-down, bottom-up, all of those things. So those are the lessons. Maybe we would implement them differently today, but I think we need to bring those dichotomies together. Okay, thank you.
There we go. So slight change of scale. I'm going to show you three sort of fairly unassuming developments that were done by New York City Housing Authority in the 90s. And it's partly, what I'm interested in here is this whole idea of an inventory of what's possible, because the received perception of sort of public housing is that it's huge towns in the park, major developments, you know, warehousing of poor people and so on. And I want to just show you that that's not necessarily the only way it can be done. And the context for this is kind of interesting. I was director of design and capital improvement for the New York City Housing Authority in the 90s. And when I got there, I found, to my surprise, that there was still some development money left in the portfolio. And it used to be originally that public housing authorities had two budgets. They had an operating subsidy for operating expenses, and they had a development budget for building new housing. And that was stopped really in the Nixon years. But NYCHA still had some of that money left, and partly because it was very difficult to spend it. And it was difficult to spend it because of the very low budgets that HUD applied per unit, you know, per capita. And also during the Reagan years, they introduced these cost containment standards, which made it sort of even more difficult. So you actually didn't have enough money in the development pipeline to really build anything, unless you could do two other things. One, provide free land, city-owned land, so you took away the land cost from the cost of the project. And secondly, using the then new low-income tax credit program to provide an additional subsidy. So those two things were a bit of a game changer. But then what also made it difficult was that the Reagan administration said, well, public housing authorities shouldn't be developing their own. It should all be done by private developers because the private sector is the answer to all of our problems, and they will come and they'll do it right. So the housing authority had to engage private developers in what was called a turnkey process. And it was called turnkey because the process was that the housing authority would hand over the land to the developer. The developer would complete the project, build it, and then when it was done, give the keys over to back to the authority, hence the term turnkey. The early attempts at this had been pretty disastrous because the developers came in, the low bidder, of course, got the job. They were all still very budget constrained anyway. The architects they used were often not the best, were generally not paid, sometimes not at all, but usually paid badly. So a lot of the early ones were really poor. On the Lower East Side, Lower East Side 2 was built, and because of the process and because of HUD cost containment standards, it was built with single-wide concrete block exterior wall. And this was cost-saving, so when I was at the Housing Authority, we had to go back and spend millions of the grant money to put the brick back on the outer wire, which cost like infinitely more than it would have cost if it had been done properly in the first place, but that's another discussion. So one of the things we did to up the game on the turnkey process was to say the way it was done, there were evaluation criteria. Cost was the most important. The experience and qualifications of the delivery team, because it was an architect, builder, syndicator who was responsible for putting together the financing. And then there was a design component. So they wouldn't let us make design the highest criteria, but they would allow us to make each category have a fail threshold. So if you came in with the lowest price and the best team, but your design was lousy and you got zero on design, you were out. You're out of the running. So it forced the developers actually to engage some better architects and to come up with some better design criteria. Otherwise, their low price wouldn't really win them the project. So we worked with the city. We got city-owned land. So the first one here is on 84th Street, and is Paula still here? Yes, Paula's still here. Well, I have to confess, this was a community garden. And I still have the arrows in my back from the community meetings when we went there to explain. And it was a lovely community garden. But you know, I've always thought that was a non-argument. You know, what's more important, housing or community gardens? You know, we can really do both. And what happened in this case, interestingly enough, is down the road, which you don't see in this image, is a school with a large playground. So we took a chunk of the playground and we moved the community garden, dug up the tarmac, put the community garden in the playground. So the community garden still had their garden. And interestingly enough, it then became part of the curriculum of the school. The school kids got engaged in the garden. So I don't think it's necessarily you know, a fight we have to have. So this was designed by Castro Blanco Piscinieri. It's 35 units, 2 and 3 bedrooms, an elevator building, 6 stories. It's totally integrated into that neighborhood. You walk by it, you wouldn't know it was public housing. It's 100% affordable, people earning less than 50% of median income. It will be affordable housing forever. It solves the in perpetuity problem. It's owned and operated by the Housing Authority. This is another example on the Lower East Side on between 8th and 9th Street and Avenue C. These are 4-story walk-ups. They're duplexes. A ground floor duplex, a top duplex. Every unit is accessible by an independent staircase, so there are no common corridors, which had been an issue that we were trying to solve. Becker and Becker were the architects. You see the walk-up. I mean, they're fairly undecorative, you know. These are very low-budget developments, but a very nice garden in the rear. which you know, reminds a little bit reminiscent of Sunnyside. I don't know, maybe. and then finally, this is actually supportive housing on Stanton and Tony Street on the Lower East Side, designed by Jim McCullough. These are units for families with an AIDS patient. So again, on city-owned land, operated, built and developed by the Housing Authority. Each family, each unit has an additional bathroom and has its own laundry facilities so that the family can support the AIDS patient. And interestingly enough, it was developed, built, and completed by the Housing Authority, but then handed over to a not-for-profit who now operates it as a supportive housing project. So I just think that in the context of an inventory of what's possible, I think we forget that there are other ways of doing things. It's not only about 80-20 and upzoning. There are creative ways to use the available land that we have. These small developer builders are actually quite capable of doing good work when they get the right architects. And these, of course, are permanent, low-income, affordable housing completely integrated into the neighborhoods in which they prevail. And I think it's an idea worth revisiting.
Thank you all. Those were fantastic presentations. And I think they've brought up a lot of issues that we can talk about. So the first is sort of, you know, brought up by your presentation, David, which is how do we get quality? You know, what do we need to do from a policy standpoint in order to get quality architects involved in housing? Who defines those standards for quality, I think, is another important question. So, you know, we were talking a lot in the last panel about how we get more community participation into dialogues about development. And part of what I was wondering is to what extent you all think that's necessary within architectural design as well. Do we still want to leave architects in the position of experts where their judgments about quality kind of reign, or do we need to have a way in which architects might have conversations with community stakeholders about quality as well? But I think it's clear, looking at all of those presentations, that in some ways, design and design quality is a way that we can have conversations about how we share resources. I mean, all of these projects are kind of examples of ones where we've really made a real investment, sometimes with a large number of funds, sometimes with smaller funds, to produce models of housing. And so those models of housing, in addition to the kind of everyday affordable housing that's produced, also help us to articulate typologies that are successful, and they help us to articulate what might be possible within low-income production that still defines quality. So I wondered if all of you could maybe comment just a little bit more on the role of architects and commissioners in defining quality in each of the projects that you've looked at. But also how you think these cases might move us forward in debates that we're having about quality today.
As far as Sunnyside Gardens goes, I mentioned yesterday that we looked at Brinkman Plaza, that the architect John Ciardullo claimed it was built at the same density as Co-op City, which he did as a kind of model. And the architects of Sunnyside and planners, because they were planners, It's what they were all about. I mean, they wrote a book about this. They used it as a case study for a project that was built at the same per square foot cost as tenements were at the time. But they were saying, so look, it's the same amount of money, but you get this quality. And you get more light, you get air, and you get nature brought into the project. So I don't have an answer for government regulation because this was in a way outside of policy, but the architects were themselves deeply, you know, committed to this notion about quality. And maybe it's because they came out of this experience of looking at what was going on in Great Britain and really analyzing. There were some social scientists that were a part of this, really analyzing what the conditions were for building in New York City, and used it as a model of how to move forward. So I don't have any other answer than that, but standards were definitely part of what, mostly what they were doing, is what they were looking at.
I think there's two things that we need to get across to the sort of policy side of housing delivery, and that's to reverse this notion that A, design costs money, and B, design is really just for wealthy people. And just the opposite is true, I think, that you know, the lower the budget, the more you need good design. And design is also, to me, an issue of social equity. It's the lower income communities, communities of color that have been denied design services. So I think our policymakers who, when they hear the word design, think, oh, you know, it's all about luxury and it's all about cost and so on. We have to reverse that. We have to correct that impression, because I think if you do that, then I think design becomes part of the solution in getting inventive answers to how you do more with less.
In a way, that gets to some of the questions that I think Paula was bringing up in her presentation earlier, that that we sort of need a new language for doing things for the sake of quality and for the sake of long-term durability, too. So there is a kind of, if we're going to put it in this sort of neoliberal cost-calculating framework, it does seem that we could add it in that way. And Bill, I think you were bringing up the philanthropic model as one that's important, too. But, there's ways in which I totally see that in Sunnyside Gardens, and yet I want to challenge that because it still relies on a model of quality that's defined by philanthropists, defined by people in a position of privilege. So I don't know, Suzanne, you were trying to question the difference between the top-down and the bottom-up model, and I wondered if you could address that.
Well, I want to pick up a distinction I think maybe Gabrielle made between the what and the how. Like, we should discuss the what first and then figure out how to do it. And I think that's also the way to integrate both, let's say, the community or the people on the ground and the experts. And I do still think that, you know, architects are architects because ideally they can envision and do things and solve spatial solutions that others can't because they have other abilities, right? So so is Daniel still here? Because I have a specific recommendation for the mayor and all the agencies. But essentially to separate the process, there's a what, a goal finding process, but then you actually opening up to a competition model, and you can say that's importing it from somewhere else, but it's an established model. You figure out what you want to do, what's financially feasible. Those are the standards, you know, whether you do the HPD bedroom size standards or you just decide on something else, and then you let a group of architects fight it out as the best possible way to do it, and then you know, that's the how question. And I think separating that, the program and the realization would be one way to go about it.
Yeah, let me just say something about the philanthropy, because it is an important issue. It's true that the East River houses built for tuberculosis patients came from Vanderbilt Trust, and the Rockefellers were involved in these. It's such an American model. When I'm thinking about philanthropy today, today we might call them nonprofits. I'm thinking about Phipps houses. I'm thinking about Common Ground. I'm thinking about Robin Hood. I mean, these are outgrowths of that model. How they get funding, we could possibly talk about, but it just seems so in the way we do business in America. And when I look at housing, and I do this through the Architects newspaper, look at housing in California and Texas, it almost always, there's almost always this, in quote, nonprofit component in the process. Mm-hmm. So I just think it's so embedded, I don't know how to get around it in America. And I don't know if we need to.
Another question that was brought up by at least your two presentations and a lot of the buildings that we saw yesterday is the role of landscape in defining quality in architecture. And David, I know you have a lot of experience with that outside of the realm of projects that you talked about. But I wondered if we could talk about landscape design as a kind of mode of producing quality. Suzanne, in the article that you had written about Twin Parks, it was actually the sort of landscape design that seemed to be one of the most convincing parts of the project that you focused on there. So if you want to say a little bit more.
Again, I think it's about teamwork, that there are different disciplines who have different sensibilities and abilities to work together. So I think that's the main. In that case, Prentice and Channelhausen brought in
a landscape architect to work together.
Could you re-summarize your arguments, like, about how the, I mean, in your article you were talking about how, in part, landscape architecture was so cheap. There was an architect who was saying, you know, I could put in high quality doorknobs if I had just, for the same amount that I spent on a landscape architect, and instead I got, you know, a plaza.
Yeah, I think that comes together with a lot of actually themes in the first panel also, that many people are starting to rethink that the value of shared assets, mm-hmm. and that will generate more than dividing it up among individual households. So I think in that case, at the Twin Parks Northeast, yeah, the argument that Terry Schnadelbach said, well, you know, I can slightly upgrade every closet door or put in a new trim somewhere, but if we bundle that money, we can actually create one shared quality open space that can be used for everyone. So just to rethink.
With in the tour yesterday, we saw this park on Intervale and Kelly Street that I had mentioned on the tour was slated for housing when they, Harry D. Ranzo's organization, Banana Kelly, and the other groups, Father Gigante, when they got together, they were asking themselves, you know, we need more housing, but we want to create a community. What do we really need here? They opened laundromats. They fought to open a, you know, corner grocery store, and they needed a park. This was something that was, you know, really necessary to making that community work as a community rather than just blocks of houses. So they, you know, overthrew the plan to put housing in that park, and now they have, you know, it's not a heavily funded park, but if you go there on a summer day, it's just full of people. It's really the center of that community.
You know, as every architect knows, as you get to the end of the project, when the value engineering comes in, it's the landscape that gets cut first, yeah. Right? It's really so. and I think it's a question of understanding the value of it. And, you know, you don't need a lot of it. Everybody doesn't have to have a central park. Often just small, well-designed outdoor spaces are really worth... I would dump the doorknobs and put them back into the landscape.
Yeah, I mean, we were seeing a little bit of that yesterday at Via Verde, too. There are rooftop gardens there that are used for community gardening, and I think they were saying produced close to 1,000 pounds of produce a year. So I wondered, like, if you could talk a little bit more about the, just to get back to that philanthropic model. So many of these projects assume that there are, you know, lifestyle changes that we need to leverage for residents, and part of Via Verde, you know, the goal there, you were saying, David, yesterday, I think, was about reducing obesity and things like that. So, again, I mean, are those criteria that are coming from communities? Are they coming from planners? Are they coming from the city? How do those big markers of quality get into the conversation?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, actually, this whole idea of health in the built environment is pretty significant now, and it, obviously it's partly because, you know, the United States is not number one in many things now, but we're number one in obesity still. So that sort of health crisis, and it's some of it is to do with nutrition, obviously, that we eat too much of the wrong things, but it's also to do with our sedentary lifestyle, and that's been, you know, planners and architects are part of the problem, you know, in terms of the way everything is drive-in, elevators everywhere. So there's a big movement now. Even the Urban Land Institute, which represents many of the speculative development people across the country, are asking, you know, how do we build healthier communities? And part of it is walkability, not driving everywhere, putting many developments were built without sidewalks, so at least making it possible for people to move more. Mm-hmm. And I think that's something that we're going to see a lot more of.
And I think that also brings up another interesting issue, which is the role of the private sector as a kind of model for public development. So I wondered if all of you might want to comment a little bit on what you might see as a good role for the private sector. So David, you were sort of saying that even the Urban Land Institute is taking up models that are developed out of public funds as inspirations for their own projects. But do we see other productive interchanges between those two groups and those two modes of development? I mean, I'm thinking a little bit of like the context of the 70s when you were talking about with Mayor Lindsay, who was so interested in trying to promote private development and increase density in the city while he could, and that became a kind of lever for a group of architects involved in the urban design group at the time to promote what they saw as architectural quality. So projects like Twin Parks came to be because there was a mayor who had kind of the support of private developers behind him, but also a group of architects that were committed to a kind of
abstract notion of quality.
Well, I think the topic of time is very important and has come up, and I think there are long-term interests and short-term interests. And if the benefit of involving multiple private players, whether they're nonprofit or for-profit or whatever, is to break up the scale of management and so on. And to have them involved in long term means that they would be interested in investing in the short term.
Right.
That it, you know, they don't have to carry the cost. Whereas the problem, the project you just mentioned, was built at lowest possible upfront cost, and then someone else has to pick up the tab. So I think there's a benefit to breaking up. On the other hand, the interesting thing about this whole discussion of what's possible is that everything has been tried before. Like every single model we've been tried.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. As you say, we think of NYCHA as one model, but NYCHA has tried everything itself. Like there's a whole portfolio of private-public collaboration, remapping of streets, mixed use. It's all been done. So I think maybe we're at a point where it would be the best, most efficient cost-benefit analysis to actually have the public sector build again. Like why, you know, the layers of fees and profits that are taken off by all these syndicators and developers. But as Nick pointed out, maybe that's not so easy. On the other hand, Nick pointed to a very real precedent that could be slightly tweaked and implemented again. So I guess there's this, yes, private sector, because there are multiple interests and players, and you can distribute the risk. On the other hand, you really have to distribute the risk. You can't then leave the risk to be picked up by the public agency at the end of the day.
No, I mean, I think the whole point about this discussion, our tour yesterday and the symposium today, is that rather than have one being obsessed with one mechanism, which is the 80-20 and the upzoning with all sorts of unforeseen consequences that are negative, let's look at what is possible. And there are so many, we saw on the tour yesterday and today, so many ways of doing it, and we should be trying them all and not just obsessing over one particular solution.
Yeah, I mean, I agree also with Suzanne that we should really think about, I really feel like we're kind of stuck with this model where the private sector, particularly from the federal government type of legislation, has to be involved in this. So maybe the idea is to think about what they can bring to the process, which is mixed affordability units. I mean, I did a show on Viennese housing 2 years ago, and Vienna has an unbelievable 60% of Viennese people live in public housing, and I know Ron's visited there, other people probably have. They're incredible, but now the European Union is forcing them to adopt a kind of private, semi-private model. They're requiring, if they're going to get money from the European Union, to have a private component into it. So they're trying to think of it in a very positive way, and they are doing mixed use, which I think, I'm not an expert on it, but just looking a little bit at what Mayor de Blasio is proposing in East New York, I don't know, that might be a fear that if you just put only affordable housing in East New York, that you're going to replicate many of the problems of East New York. You're kind of creating a zone of only a poor population. But of course, in New York, the wealthy have so many different options. It's the poor that need the options. So it's a kind of mixed bag. But as we were saying, that maybe the idea is to look at what could be gained from that, because I just don't see that for-profit component of this American model being done away with. It just doesn't seem likely to me.
Do we have questions from the audience? If you have them, you can just come right up to the microphone.
It's Ted.
About Twin Parks. 40 years ago, when Twin Parks was finished, there were community rooms with glass that opened onto the open space. There were there was a housing management group within UDC that had post-construction evaluation of those projects, which suggested how things could improve in the next round of housing. There was a long-term view of how we could supervise the keeping, the upkeep for these buildings. And 40 years later, when the community rooms are blocked off, it's a tragedy. And when the landscape is stripped, it's a tragedy. And I think that with this top-down, bottom-up, public supervision or eyes looking at the management, that management is something that honestly is a very important part of the long-term success. And the other thing I want to mention is this in the 80-20 as being the model. Remember that Roosevelt Island started at 50-50. There was a 50% low income in Roosevelt Island when it worked beautifully for the first 5 years before that changed. And we shouldn't hold ourselves to thinking that poor and moderate and middle and market rate people can't live together. They can do that very well.
Thank you.
Yes, I was wondering, do you have
Let me just introduce Ted Liebman, who just spoke, because he was the head of the Urban Development Corporation when that was built and did a lot of innovation in bringing people into the city, the architects who hadn't looked at affordable housing and actually studied the whole idea of high density, low rise housing, a number of others. My apology for thought it was good. Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah, I was wondering if you guys had any opinion on the affordable housing component from modular that Forest City Ratner is trying to do right now and how that would impact it.
Are you talking about B2? Yes. B2 project? Yeah.
Yes.
I don't quite know what to say about the affordable part of it. I mean, it's a really interesting project, and they've had some, just in terms of the modular, they've had some difficulties getting it logistically, although it's a very impressive process they have over at the Navy Yard where they're doing the fabrication. I mean, I think it's probably still the largest high-rise modular ever built, and I think the jury is still out on how they turn that into a rational way of doing work. They've learned a lot from that project, but I think it's interesting to see how they move forward. But as to if your question's about how does that impact the affordability, I don't think that's the question. I think it's just a question of how do you use modular as a way of delivering more quickly and more cheaply, and they're still working on that.
There's also a lot of labor issues involved in using modular as well. Okay, next question.
When you look back at these projects, like the Twin Parks, and you study the successes and failures, do you see those failures as being a problem on the design side or a post-occupancy challenge that you couldn't foresee? And full disclosure, I work for Richard Meyer, so.
I think you can't separate the parts, right? So there are countless examples of brutalist 30-story high-rise towers that used to be all public housing in London. They've been privatized, and now they're the hippest place to live, right? So that brings up the question: okay, who lives in who lives in a building?
Architects.
Right. So it's clearly it's not as Meredith mentioned in the introduction. Pruitt-Igoe, you can blame the design. But there are 10 reasons why that was doomed to failure, because the low rent was supposed to pay for the maintenance, which if you have people living in there that have no income, it's not going to pay for the maintenance because there's no money coming in. There was a provision that you could not have, the father couldn't live with the mother. They were poor, otherwise the mother wouldn't get the welfare. So, of course, there were no men in the building, and it was just single parents. I mean, like a slew of things. The project was planned when the idea was St. Louis was going to grow and industrialize. It actually was realized when jobs were fleeing the city. So is it the design? Of course, the design has something to do with it. But I think you talk to any developer, a single-point access building like Via Verde could be the model. It's great. You have a single point of access. But, 10 years earlier, everybody was saying, no, you have to have stoops, and everybody has to have their own little walk-up building, and that's much safer. So it's, it's the whole component of
who lives there, who manages it, where the money's coming from. I don't know.
Yeah, and I think the idea is not to say that design doesn't matter, but we have to make it matter in the ways that it actually matters, right? And find sort of new ways of both quantifying that from cost standpoints and commissioning standpoints, but also through conversations with people that are using the building to make sure that they have the amenities they need. I think we have time for maybe one more question.
Sort of a design question about... It relates to the discussion of landscape, but about open space in general. I feel like with public housing and affordable housing, often open space sometimes is seen as being one of the successes of the project, like with Sunnyside, but also sometimes seen as one of the failures, like in the Twin Parks example. And I guess I just wanted the panel's thoughts on what's the difference between a successful, what makes a successful open space in a public housing project.
Right. Well, I think from Sunnyside, again, it's kind of linking all of these last questions is that it was meant to be community owned and community maintained. Unfortunately, they had a problem with the way New York City would allow property like that. The banks had a problem with it, basically, because they didn't understand how somebody could sell on and then, as part of their ownership, sell community-based property. So there was a 30 or 40 or forget how many year time period that this could take place. And then after that, it kind of ended, and many people started grabbing the community space for their private space, and it remains that way because they sold it on. So just agreeing with other people that in this point it's really about policy and how you set it up, not just the design. I mean, that's the same problem I had with the micro apartments. I mean, how much money can you get for a micro apartment in Midtown Manhattan? You know, you could get $5,000 a month for a micro apartment in Manhattan, but it depends on, is it rental? Is it meant for a population that needs it, that can, that can live in it? So.
Thanks. Okay, I think it's time for us to wrap up this panel, but I'd like to thank the panelists and all of the audience members for this conversation.
Thank you all very much. We're going to take the fastest coffee break that you've ever seen. And I wanted to point out, you know, there's obviously a ton of amazing work going on at Pratt in housing. And if you look where you checked in, there's a slideshow showing some beautiful work of housing studios conducted by professors who are in the audience. So please take a look at that, and we'll come back in probably 6 minutes. Thanks.